extremely impatient about the same thing for a very long time. And I think that sums up a lot of people actually here tonight. St. Teresa of Avila said that Christ has no body on earth but ours, and Oscar Romero said our job is to put feet on the gospel. And I think between the two of them, they cover what I understand Christian Aid to be all about. I'm very proud to be associated with Christian Aid, and Paul St. Martin's to be associated with Christian Aid and everything that it stands for. I've got two things to say to you. First of all, is that we have stewards here tonight. If you hear a ghastly fire alarm, you've heard nothing as loud and unpleasant in your entire life. And the stewards will get you out of here very, very quickly. Please do exactly what they tell you to do. The gathering point is over behind the big tree over there, and that's even if it's wet. And the other thing that I have great pleasure in telling you is that there will never be a better time for you to switch off your mobile phone. This is an opportunity not to be missed and to be taken up by your presence. Thank you for being here tonight. Your presence is a physical demonstration of your commitment, and I'm glad to be here. Thank you.
Thank you, Sam. Christian Aid is very grateful for the way that St. Martin in the field supports our work. And I'd like to thank you again for hosting our second annual lecture. So I'd like to extend a warm welcome to everybody here this evening. My name is Patrick Watt, I'm the Chief Executive of Christian Aid. And we're delighted to be joined today by the Shadow Secretary of State for Foreign, Commonwealth and Development Affairs, the Right Honourable David Lammy, MP. It's also a great privilege to be joined by our Chair, Dr. John Sentamu, former Archbishop of York, and by Rachel Womath, Deputy Political Editor of the New Statesman. And we're very pleased to be joined by all of you here this evening, Christian Aid supporters and friends, friends in our sponsoring churches, in Parliament and Government, from across civil society and beyond. So before I introduce this evening's speaker properly, I wanted briefly to outline the format of the event. So after the Shadow Foreign Secretary has given his lecture, Rachel will host the conversation between David and Paul Sentamu. And Rachel will then open up that conversation to you, our audience, and I hope you will therefore use the time when they're in conversations thinking about the questions that you would like to ask. Today's event is being live streamed, so if you do want to ask a question, please be aware you're going to be recorded for posterity on camera. And if you want to post on Twitter, I hope I'm not contradicting Sam's instruction here on mobile phones, we are using the hashtag CALecture, capital C, capital A, capital L. So, this is Christian Aid's second annual lecture, as I said. We were joined about this time last year by Sarpata Dasgupta, the noted economist and the author of the government's report on the economics of biodiversity. And our hope is that this annual lecture provides an opportunity for a diverse group of people to meet, to be stimulated by a distinguished speaker, and encouraged to think together about the major challenges facing our world in relation to Christian Aid's mission and goals. Now, it hardly needs to say that we're holding today's lecture in a context where we're facing formidable challenges. Last year's lecture was one of the first face-to-face events that Christian Aid was able to convene after the easing of pandemic restrictions. And 1 year on, I don't think any of us expected the impact of the pandemic to then be exacerbated by the war in Ukraine, and for us now to be facing a global cost-of-living crisis. What has been widely predicted over many years was that the effects of climate change would get significantly worse. But what we've actually seen is the intensification of the climate crisis is now happening more quickly than most expert opinion anticipated. Climate-related humanitarian disasters, from the floods in Pakistan to the worst drought in East Africa in decades, are becoming more severe and frequent and creating waves of human misery in their wake. And of course, the people first and worst affected are those who've done least to contribute to the problem. Now, since becoming Chief Executive of Christian Aid in May of this year, I've had the opportunity to see the impact of some of these crises at first hand. So I've met with our partners and communities with whom we work in Malawi, in Ukraine, in India, and in Afghanistan. And I've seen how the economic fallout from COVID-19, the climate crisis, and conflict are combining to push people into poverty. I've also seen the practical difference that Christian Aid makes to people of all religions and none. Now, Christian Aid, we believe poverty is a scandal, but ending the injustice of extreme poverty in this time of crisis therefore requires fresh approaches to tackle inequality, strengthen people's voice, and confront abuses of power. And it's in that context that we're delighted to be joined by David Lammy, MP. David delivers today's lecture after what has been a tumultuous period in British politics, and with the next general election coming closer into view. Now, as many of you will know, David has been the MP for Tottenham since 2000 and a shadow on the Secretary more recently. He's one of the leading agenda setters in the fields of social activism and equality, and he was a member of the previous Labour government. David led the campaign for the Windrush generation to be granted British citizenship and paid compensation, and has been at the forefront of the fight for justice for families affected by the tragedy of the Grenfell fire. He has also published the widely recognised review into the treatment of and outcomes for Black, Asian, and minority ethnic people in the criminal justice system. He's been a good friend of Christian Aid for many years, and we are therefore very grateful to him for joining us today to deliver his lecture, A Force for Good, Cooperating Across Borders in an Age of Authoritarians.
Can I say it's a wonderful, wonderful honour to be asked to give this lecture at Christian Aid. 40 years ago, as a young man with big Michael Jackson hair, standing on doorsteps with my mother and sister during Christian Aid Week, knocking on doors at Tottenham, asking people to give. I just can't convey to you how remarkable it is that I'm standing here as Shadow Foreign Secretary giving this lecture. I know deep in my heart, and I've known for all of my life, that this is an organisation that fights injustice, supports victims of humanitarian emergencies, and of course is central to defending human rights. And the Christian faith that my mother taught me has always been and will always be central to my own values. And I want to just say why that is. It's because in the example of Jesus, we learn of a man willing to challenge power. Not simply saying that this is sad, but that this is wrong. Someone who sought to end cruelties and injustices because he saw in every single one of us one of his father's children. And I believe it was in this spirit in 1952 that a group of Labour MPs, led by the future Labour Prime Minister Harry Wilson, published a pamphlet called War on What. It set out not only for the UK, but for the whole of the global north and our allies, transcending all our immediate problems. The war on what we said a year before, the gap between the rich and the poor of the earth is the supreme challenge of the next 50 years. Let me say that again. The gap between the rich and the poor of the earth is the supreme challenge. Because here too, where individuals recognizing that gaps in wealth, in dignity, in power, offend us on a moral level just as much as suffering touches us on an emotional level. And that is what I want to talk to you about tonight, about how we can have a new development approach fit for the 2020s that addresses questions of power and inequality. Just as vigorously as that way the government sought to tackle the very worst forms of poverty we then face. It would be wrong to fail to recognise the progress, of course, that the world has made since Harold Wilson was launching his war on want. In 1950, nearly two-thirds of the world were living in extreme poverty. Today, the figure is estimated at around 9%. Hundreds of millions have indeed been lifted out of the most dire poverty. Smallpox eradicated, infant and youth mortality vastly reduced, vaccination rates of preventable diseases have soared. Extraordinary progress has been made, and yet few look around the world with optimism at this moment. Today we face enormous challenges, old and new, immediate and long term. It was 20 years ago today that another engine, Action, asked me to be a trustee on their board, and I served on their board for many years at the beginning of my career as a member of Parliament. I look around the world today, and we are facing acute humanitarian crisis. Not only stubborn poverty and pervasive inequality, but famine, conflict, climate change, refugee and migration flows, and global health and security. Earlier this year, I was sitting in a classroom in District 17 on the northwest outskirts of Kabul with a group of women helping children displaced by war in Afghanistan. One told me that she was considering selling her kidney so she could put food on the table for her family. Another woman explained to me that she was having suicidal thoughts. A third asked me, two or three generations have suffered. Will another generation suffer? Should we have hope, or is it just hopeless? In Afghanistan alone, more than 18 million people are facing potentially life-threatening food insecurity. But this is just one pocket of desperation in a world that's becoming increasingly insecure. Drought is gripping the Horn of Africa. Up to 26 million people will face food shortages in Kenya, Ethiopia, and Somalia over the next 6 months. In Lebanon, real terms, food inflation has spiked by 72%. And according to the World Food Programme, 345 million are facing acute food insecurity in 82 countries across the globe. A new global coalition, Hungry for Action, of which many of you in this room are part, has been formed to campaign against what is a moral outrage. Standing in the tradition from the anti-apartheid struggle to Jubilee 2000 and make poverty history. But whilst this method shares its heritage with those great campaigns of the past, it's also new because for the first time it brings the worlds of development and domestic poverty together. Something I know that Christian Eliot has been keen to do for much of its history. Because it cannot be right to say to my constituents in Tottenham that their care in this terrible cost of living crisis we're facing somehow matters less than that of our brothers and sisters overseas. The sleepless nights of a worried mother who knows there's nothing to give her children for breakfast if they're spent in her pizza or in hanging are just as important. The answer to those who say charity begins at home cannot be you don't know how lucky you are. No, it must be that we stand together because no child should be hungry with anyone at any time. And when we live in a world of plenty and essential promise, charity might be given hope, but it certainly shouldn't end. So this idea that when we stand together as people experiencing inequality wherever we are in the world is one of the many ways the world has changed since Labour came to power 25 years ago in 1997. And it's not only that that's different. On the one hand, COVID, the global financial crisis, the global energy crisis, climate emergency shows that the world is more interdependent than ever before, with our fates more closely intertwined. But on the other hand, our world is more divided, more aggressive, more transactional, more short-termist, more dangerous. In 1997, the UK economy was almost double the size of China's. Today, China has an economy that is roughly six times the size of the United Kingdom. Where economic gravity has shifted, international institutions have been put under strain. The UN, of course, remains absolutely vital. But Russia's veto on the Security Council limits its power. Populists and autocrats are blocking the path to progress, pursuing narrow nationalist interests and fanning the flames of division. Our problems require collective solutions, but collective action seems harder than ever. And as we neglect the multinational institutions that have been at the heart of so much progress, China is intent on reshaping the world, in some places, replacing that world, creating their own institutions through which to make investments and to deliver aid. Western development assistance is just one part of the shifting financial flow. ODA from donor countries totaling $180 billion last year is dwarfed by the way, by the which were $773 billion last year, more than four times that only for donor countries. And funding and debt from authoritarian states are reshaping the development. These funds come without restraints and expectations of development assistance, but without the strings attached. It's no coincidence which countries in the global south have abstained on UN votes instead of condemning Putin's illegal invasion. The role of the IMF is now rivaled by Chinese investment, which is now the largest official bilateral creditor to more than half of the world's 73 poorest countries. Visit the capitals of the developing world, and it's glaringly obvious the sheer scale of investment and construction from the Chinese. We're still working out how to compete in this current reality whilst remaining committed to our values, but we do not have time to waste. And in the decade ahead, these trends reshaping the world will only intensify. The most significant of all, of course, is the climate emergency, the greatest challenge that the world faces. The UN warned recently that the world is on course for a catastrophic 2.8 degrees centigrade of warming, in part because the promises made at COP26 a year ago have not been fulfilled. This would be with devastating consequences for our natural world and dangerous destabilizing effects for all countries. It would usher in an era of cascading risks as the uncontrolled effects of the global heating result of more frequent extreme heat, sea levels rising, drought, and of course famine. And this would end up, by the way, hitting us here in the UK too. We're seeing its effect already. Floods, heat waves coming along, not being in the session. Global heating will hurt us all. But the truth is that developing countries and people living in poverty are the most exposed to the worst consequences of climate emergency. I've just returned from COP27 in Egypt, where the issue of loss and damage is front and center. The agreement to create a new fund is an important step forward in recognizing the consequences of the climate crisis for the world's most climate vulnerable countries. This is a matter of solidarity. And the reality that those most likely to be affected by climate justice and climate change are the least able to afford to adapt to it. The UK government already supports poorer countries to cut emissions and to adapt to climate change. Loss and damage is about coping with the disastrous effects. But on the necessary actions to keep global warming to 1.5 degrees, yet again, we hear the unmistakable sound of the can being kicked down the road. And as a result, we're now running at risk. Too many countries were clearly resistant to what is required, including action on fossil fuels. And the government's leadership, I'm afraid, has been weak. The Prime Minister happened to be embarrassed with even showing up, meaning the government can step up, delivering cheap, homegrown, zero carbon power at home, so we have the credibility to pressure other countries to fulfill their obligations and play their part. Given what is at stake, it is easy, of course, to be pessimistic. But I still believe that multilateralism, incremental and imperfect as it may be, remains our best hope to face our common challenges. The rise of geopolitical competition just makes the context harder. And we need to work much harder to show that multilateralism works in the interests of the whole world, not just in the interests of the most prosperous nations. Development and diplomacy are our best tools in the fight against poverty, conflict, and climate change. But instead of straining to make multilateralism work, I'm afraid our government has sometimes seemed intent on breaking our relationships and trashing our reputation. 12 years of the Conservative government have left Britain badly disengaged, forgetting that sharing vaccines and investing in global health makes our citizens less likely to experience deadly pandemics. Forgetting that tackling climate change will stop sea levels rising and submerging British towns. Forgetting that reducing key drivers of the refugee crisis, poverty and conflict will make our more secure world forever. Under this government, the Conservatives have knocked down the pillars upon which Britain's development leadership is built. First, they retreated from Britain's commitments, cutting our development target from 0.7 to 0.5, and stripped billions from vital aid programs in the process. They lost credibility by failing to meet promises on climate and COVID. Then they undermined delivery, overseeing a bum merger between the UK and the Foreign Office, deprioritizing development, sapping morale, pushing out expertise. Now they're projected to spend £3 billion of the development budget here in the United Kingdom to cover the costs of incoming refugees, meaning billions in foreign aid will never leave these shores. Their retrograde strategy for development takes a transaction approach to aid which risks repeating the worst mistakes of the past. The improvement in the UK's credibility on aid after the horrors of the Pogo Dam was not a matter of chance, but of choice. The choice to untie aid and focus it on the goal of poverty eradication. The Conservative approach to trade is today a shameful shambles, as none other than George Eustace has recently found the courage after office to concede. It reflects not so much a mindset of global Britain, but little England. The Tories fail to understand that neglecting the challenges of climate, conflict, famine, and global health makes us all less safe and will work against Britain's national interests in the long term. The shift towards aid in making the transaction is not only damaging our reputation for development, it reduces our diplomatic influence. When we have a clear moral purpose, focused on helping those in need, there is less suspicion from our own agenda. The time for post-imperialist delusions is over. It's time for a new and more effective approach that brings me back, if you like, to where I started, with the idea that we shouldn't have any sort of hidden agenda, but a public and a radical one. Our ambition should be nothing less than redistributing power to people, particularly women and girls, at the sharpest edge of inequality at home and around the world. For Britain's development to get back on track, I believe that we do need a change of government. We need a Labour government on board. It won't be needed to look at history to know that we are the party that can be trusted in this area of full support. What has today become known as international development arose originally from a plan to extract even more profit from the colonies. After World War I, Britain experienced large-scale unemployment. UK politicians reasoned that if British colonies were given loans for capital projects that required British imports, unemployment at home would reduce. The 1924 Trade Facilities Act did just this. By 1929, the Colonial Development Fund was established for 10 years of up to $1 million. The fund was predominantly targeted at the then West Indies and Africa. It was presented as a colony, as an interest in Britain, rather than the colonies, which is themselves. And it was not until the 1950s that Britain's thinking towards international development began to mature. And this happened for two reasons. One, first, Britain's empire was rapidly. And second, there was a growing international recognition that richer countries would need to assist poorer countries on their journey to economic and social progress. The United States, which at the time provided two-thirds of resources to developing nations, demanded fairer burden sharing, particularly after the Second World War. And the issue moved up the agenda of the new United Nations. But it was not until the Labour government in 1964 that a ministry for overseas development was finally created. Harold Wilson, who has helped write the war on world pamphlet, finally got his wish. In 1997, Labour created the Department, of course, for International Development, which became renowned around the world. More importantly, the structural model was the seismic shift in ambition that Labour brought to development policy. Under the leadership of Tony Blair and Gordon Brown, we set our sights on the eventual target of 0.7%. And it was one of the greatest successes of our last period in office. Through international aid, Labour helped lift 3 million people out of poverty each year. 1.5 million people got improved water and sanitation services. 3 million people got access to HIV drugs, particularly following the AIDS epidemic. And we helped 40 million extra children go to school who otherwise would not have done. We have made huge progress in so and eradicating hunger. At Glenny, since 2005, the Labour-led international campaign to cancel 100% of multilateral debts for the world's poorest countries. But while securing an extra $1 billion in September 2008, the UK played a key role, of course, in the London Conference, making progress in the area of food, on education, and on health. And we supported the Environmental Transformation Fund, anticipating an urgent need to tackle climate change. One of Labour's lasting achievements has been to forge a new political consensus around development. And that was a great interest, but it should be rigorous, transparent, focused on effectiveness and value for money. And that it is something that Britain could truly be proud of. And to their credit, David Cameron and George Osborne sustain that commitment, keeping Britain on the path to 0.7% that Labour first set us on. And while there is much that I disagree with them on that, this was an important era of broad cross-party consensus. Under numerous Tory Prime Ministers since then, I'm afraid, Boris Johnson, with trust, Rishi Sunak, that consensus has broken down. And at the time when, as I described earlier, the humanitarian movement soared, not fall. And the challenges of famine, conflict, and climate threaten our security. So what do we need to do? Labour made Britain a world leader in development before, and I believe that we can do it again. In a world of global challenges and political divides, we need both a long-term transformation and political nous of good, solid diplomacy. Both will be essential if we continue the hard work towards the ambitions of the Sustainable Development Goals of the world. We must be able to lead by example once more and not break our word on commitments. That goes for treaties that we sign up to with our closest partners here in Europe, or the promises we made to deliver climate finance to the developing world. It means not reducing our focus on development while asking others to do more. It means not preaching to others about net zero without a credible plan to get there ourselves. It means rediscovering the core principles that should guide us, our commitment to human rights, democracy, and the rule of law. But our approach to that must also evolve with the world that we're living in today. We must be realistic about the role and contribution of Western donors. Development finance and policy are vital, but they are not the only, or indeed the main driver of global economic development. Overstating our own needs downplays the other profound forces of work and undermines the agency of developing countries themselves. Instead, we must be focused on where we can really make a difference. We must adapt to a world where lower and middle income countries across Africa and Asia have greater economic weight and greater economic political influence. Our approach should be grounded in a deeper understanding of our own history and the way people in many countries in the global south view the historical role of the United Kingdom. It's got to be sensitive to the criticisms of aimed at patronizing or paternalistic and build instead modern equals and relations of power. Two-way partnerships based on respect and mutual trust. And I think that the example of the development sector's understandable preoccupation with the fair distribution of vaccines around the world. It is, of course, an injustice that millions of Europeans were vaccinated many times over, while much of the world waiting for their first dose. All because a few wealthy nations stockpiled more vaccines than they could ever use. And this cannot happen again. But our goal has to be bigger. Bigger than just that. For intellectual property and manufacturing capacity to be shared across the world, so that countries are producing their own vaccines, not just waiting for our leftovers. And you've got to ask, why the international development sector worth shouting around the world? That's what I mean when I talk about power. The old slogan of justice, not charity. I want us to go further and think not just about justice bestowed, but power claimed. The power of people to chart their own futures. Development policy must be rooted in the aspiration for lives of dignity and opportunity across the world. I'm sure that everyone in the room shares that aspiration. And we must show that being a good partner to a low-income country is not only a great British tradition, but an opportunity for our growth and prosperity too. Our development agenda must respond to the vast needs of financial investment across the developing world from a range of sources. Development should support the role of effective public services in the developing world to help support capable, accountable governments. We must work alongside trade union movement partners overseas to strengthen workers' rights and fair labour practices. I'm convinced that we can do more to share the experience of Britain's most beloved institution at home, the National Health Service, to support the universal health coverage award. And it must address twin drivers of climate change and conflict, championing the green energy transition, climate finance, and supporting peace building and conflict prevention. And let me explain some of the ways Labour is set out doing this. First, we will become one of the world's leading convenors. Our new foreign and security policy pact with the European Union will enable a constructive working forum with our European partners. We will use our deep relationship with the United States to strengthen collaboration on development. We will use our membership of the United Nations Security Council, the G7, the G20, to move development further up the international agenda. And the Commonwealth provides a unique opportunity to partner with the Global South. As my great colleague Ed Miliband has outlined, we will build a clean power alliance of developed and developing countries committed to renewable energy. And if we prioritise development in all of the world's world, Britain can become one of the world's best connected and trusted leaders on it. And Labour will be strategic in its approach to forming new partnerships with African nations. There is far more that the United Kingdom can do to support aspirations in the most climate vulnerable continent, but also the continent with the greatest potential for increased development and prosperity over the coming century. Second, we will use the power of example to extend the UK's soft power. From our leadership of development to the brilliance of the UK's civil service and the British Council, our credibility starts from the strength of our support to home for these vital institutions of the UK soft power. Not by exchanging aid for trade, that would be the absolute opposite. By offering the best of Britain's partners in their own development. We need to offer an alternative to China's physical infrastructure and link to British innovation in education, in governance, in healthcare, and support their own development. Third, yes, we will get Britain back on track to meet its commitment to the UN's 0.7% development target as soon as possible, this way the situation allows. And let me address today why even At a time of real economic hardship and fiscal constraint, I believe it is unequivocal in the UK's national interest to restore the UK's leadership in international development. For me, the answer is deep and deeply personal. The roots of my politics are nourished by the belief in the equal worth of every human being. A world that's unequally divided offends that fundamental belief. It demands a response based on solidarity, not simply sympathy. It demands a response based on justice, not charity. It demands a response based on dignity, not dependence. And it demands a response that recognises that the UK, here in the UK, we have a real national interest in a world that's more equal, more sustainable, and more stable. So for me, the case for the UK's leadership in international development combines a moral and strategic dimension. It's not only morally right approach, it's also a strategically smart approach. It's about who we are and the world we want to live in. We want our children to live and our grandchildren to live. And we will target this development for the most important, prioritising early, smart and innovative development interventions. Getting people into decent employment using locally driven information and organisations. Restoring the role of our trade unions in supporting development policy and programmes through their partnerships with sister level organisations across the world and using private sector finance with interests aligned. For example, the International Investment Committee's partnership with Google in Nigeria, which uses satellite imagery to trigger cash payments to communities in advance of extreme weather events. We will set up a new task force to coordinate private sector support for development finance in line with the government's priorities. Fourth, learning the lessons of the government's funding merger, we will create a new model for international development to meet the challenges of the 21st century. Labour has always maintained that development and diplomacy are related but distinct, and our new model should have independence needed to reflect those important differences and empower both to meet the challenges of the 21st century. We are working at the moment on one of the best structures of delivery to restore transparency, value for money, and focus on international development. And we are consciously and purposely looking outwards, not inwards, and forward, not back, in undertaking this work. We're looking at best practice in the sector internationally and looking at what are the challenges in the coming decades. In this task, development organisations like this journey have a crucial role and we want more help. As we continue this work, we want to hear your fresh thinking on how we meet the development challenges of tomorrow. Just as in the past, it will forward to an incoming government to once again move the UK development efforts back into a position of international leadership. So they're determined to do the work, look at the evidence, and reach the correct. Fifth, we remain committed to a feminist development policy, away from the world's gains and millions of school-age girls across Africa face forced marriage with all the dangers and humiliations of the risk for a child's life. We've seen the shameful deletion of references to protecting women and girls' reproductive rights that have been extended to freedom of religion and belief. Gender equality. As we approach the 16 days of activism against gender-based violence, Labour reaffirms its commitment to the UN Sustainable Development Goals on reaching gender equality. And sixth, we will recognise the inextricable link between tackling the climate crisis and global development for all. A Labour government will campaign for climate action to become a fourth pillar of the United Nations Charter. And push for a new international law on ecocide to criminalise the willful and widespread destruction of the environment. And as our excellent Shadow Cabinet Minister for Development Group Guild set out at the conference, Labour will legislate to make sure that Britain's aid budget makes climate action a priority. The world of today is increasingly insecure. Too many people live under authoritarian regimes, denied the dignity of democracy. And we millions will be praying for and thinking of a little bit around in these recent days. Too many are still in poverty, while the gap between them and the super rich grows. COVID and climate change show how disease and disaster know no borders. International groups, multinational institutions, and political leadership are needed more than ever. Throughout our history, Britain has played a leading role in establishing this system, helping to create institutions like the United Nations and NATO. But today, our leaders in government are on this agenda, acting outside the rule of law for domestic and short-term reasons, undermining the system that keeps our people safe in a main effort to protect their own jobs. The Conservatives have focused more on protecting themselves than protecting others. Britain can be better than this. Britain must be better than this. It's time to repair our relationships with our allies around the world. It's time to revitalize our nation's soft power, influence and impact and the new strategy for modernizing international law. Restore the influence of multinational institutions like the United Nations. Once again, reach the target of 0.7 because it's in our national interest for Britain to be that force for good. Only by playing our role in fixing the problems of our world will we be able to provide security and prosperity at home. In a dark age of authoritarianism and populism, Labour will shine a light of democracy, multilateral system, and human greatness once again.
Simply give you the advice.
climate justice, question of laws in darkness. As a matter of solidarity, it's not because we're being good in the country. It's actually a matter of solidarity because there is only one race, and that's the human race. And because that's the truth, that's why you go the way you go. Secondly, a shift from focus on poverty elsewhere to inequality everywhere. Question of power and inequality of the embassy of inequality, justice, and love. And we see that this question of tackling poverty is not just again a question of charity. It is because you and I are brothers and sisters. What do we have to do? We may have different colors, diversities, and things, but actually, what makes us who we are as human beings, really loved, unique, and of great worth. You recognize these challenges. Much is not a time of shifting power in geopolitics. And it isn't about those who are very rich building it out for those who are very poor, but actually working. In fact, in the way Christian aid works, we're no longer doling it out, but actually finding on the ground the people who can implement the reality of it. So partnership is really at the heart of it. A little preacher went over the village trying to talk about giving, and he said to the gentleman, if you have two girls and God said to you, give one to the poor person and you keep one. And he said, Vicar, that's a very unfair question, because you know I've got two girls. The critique again of this transactional, which looks like an approach, once you tie aid and development to trade, the problem is we're simply going forward together. And I'm not so sure that's a good way. The ways all come back in front of us, whose names are really support the people who you think are well supported, but the politics are on your side. And you see this as something which globally we're going to deal with. It's too long, I think. In the last 20, 30 years, globalization has become a byword. We don't actually see ourselves as living in one village, but like Earth, and all other people are neighbors. The breakdown of the consensus, material need is soaring, not falling, and the challenge of famine, conflict, and climate threaten our security. Today, in the House of Lords, we have what they call oral questions. There was a question about children in school who are suffering hunger, and the chief inspector of schools said on the 5th of October found that 83% of primary school teachers had said that children were coming to school anyway. And of course the question was, what is the government doing about it? When the answer came back, we are now have provided free school meals for a lot of children than at any other time. But the lady answering the question did not see the double-edged sword of her answer. More school meals for all children than at any other time. Why? If she thought about it, poverty. The rising number of free school meals, in the end, say, there are quite a lot of people who are making it to the kids are out of school everything, so hungry. So the background of consensus is very close. And you've given us what we're going to do, so tease out from my first one. With exception, we've had the commitment to going back to 0.7, which, by the way, when it was changed, was promised, will only be for 2.5 years. this past. I was in Parliament when the 1.7 was agreed as an act of Parliament, not a wish. And to take it away, we had to go through Parliament. And if you remember, most people from all sides didn't want this. Is that right? We shall go into it. Three areas we knew about morality and religion. That is ethics. In Nigeria, where I've been leading a commission on pollution, oil pollution in the Niger Delta place, where most people's blood has been tested, I mean, in some of their cases, 60% is polluted with oil. And people talk about corruption, but for me that's too weak. The phrase I've been using is organized theft on an unprecedented scale, because that's theft. So, right, that's the thing we want to come back to. Building a public political consensus on aid and development, loss and damage of 27, and the areas where the, if you remember, at the end of COP 27, the UN Secretary General said there should be new tax on polluters to pay for it. Cleansing the Niger Delta, I'm afraid those who pollute in the world and kids, and we born, and the premature deaths are high in that part of Nigeria than elsewhere. Finally, the role of the private sector. Again, I have a debate. All in all, thank you very much. And for those of you who stuck with us in September, like the director here has said, thank you. Thank you for staying with us for this lecture.
Thank you very much. Just to explain to people how this evening will work, or I'll take what these guys through some questions, then I'll give everyone else a chance to check in for those who want to ask some questions. So I guess a good place to start with is COP, as you were said there last week, and in particular the Loss and Damage Fund, which was agreed was a big achievement, but we don't know who's going to pay and don't know who's going to be able to claim from it. So how would a Labour government ensure the Loss and Damage Fund becomes a political reality rather than just a statement?
We'll kind of step back a bit from COP, because COP, even one COP, takes us away from a principal institution that stands behind a global movement to bring countries together to determine and take action on climate emergency, and that institution is the United Nations. And I still believe, despite the problems of the Security Council, particularly the problems of veto, the problems of Russia and China, the failure of India, Africa, Japan, and the President of the Security Council, that it's important to put on record the tremendous foundation of having, post the Second World War, an international institution that brings the whole global community together to determine the future, and recognizing that both in the United Nations and in COP, we are limited by our very nature and human difference. It's my sincere hope that it doesn't fall to an end government to determine the contribution that countries should make and have created and contributed massively to the hurricanes, the famines, the droughts that we're seeing across the world, because I hope that will deter it to not before. I suspect the next election will come back. But I would say this, the scale of the damage that we're talking about, it's important to recognize, eclipses what we have traditionally seen as international development aid burden. Therefore, we will also have to be innovative in how we finance that. And so I do think that it's right that new finance banking investment models are put together alongside insurance models, alongside the more traditional aid models to get us to the bigger outside that is required. Because, you know, if you're in the Caribbean region where much of my family are, your business of hurricanes is an annual event and damage is quite sensitive. So,
John,
are
you
going to speak
a little bit about
the loss and damage from the Caribbean? COP 20, the questionnaire produced an amazing small one stone, different boats. If you're in a canoe and another person is in a bigger boat, and both of you actually have a lot of rain coming, the canoe is the one most likely to self-stand. The bigger boat will sail on. And that message of the good people, if you went to Samoa or Fiji, the towers are down and some of their areas, one night, two islands, simply went under. Everybody underwater, they were buried alive. When they went down in the boat, they pray, please God, protect me, my little boat, because your sea is so vast. And what that sea has done is marriage. It's absolutely devastation. So our attention to places where our brothers and sisters have actually been buried alive and the water. And we look at yourself. You just come. Leave it behind. One school, different boats. We don't want to be in the same boat so that together is alive. And that's going to require a lot of effort, just like the Jubilee 2000, a campaign of conservation of our dead. Could we begin to get a new movement that actually takes this seriously everywhere?
Raising the bar for critical emissions and the phasing out of fossil fuels. We're doing 600 fossil fuel lobbyists at the event. Do you both think that COP is still working, or do you think it could be modified or replaced?
For me personally, my worry is what the president of COP 2022 said. I mean, the communicate to come out, it's very good to get all this help from those people and whatever it was, but what actually was it in a recommitment to 1.5, a recommitment to quite a lot of what happened, and galvanized that fantastic happening in Glasgow. How do we regain it? But actually, if you don't do it, we're burying our future children alive.
So, do you think the COP is working?
This is very largely a Christian community. And so I'm thinking back to different eras where Christians woke up to serious injustice, campaigned, organized, and moved the world. And what's coming to my heart is the story of my ancestors and enslavement, and that being a truth of European countries for hundreds of years, but then getting to a point where this country, this great country, outlawed that trade, police waters, and by the end of the 19th century, we saw the abolition of slavery across much of the world. I think it's really important that we say this categorically, that the Labour Party is absolutely clear that if we are to call the next government, we will grant no new licences for oil and fossil fuel exploration in the North Sea oil. It comes to an end. And we will lead that charge across the world because we have to wean ourselves off fossil fuels. And we have to race to renewables. We have to just really run fast to that. And in a sense, the problems of Ukraine and energy dependence demonstrate that that's what we should be doing. And so, of course, we're in a persuasive business. But I think, and we're running out of time, but I just say to you with humility that I'm quite sure a lot of people felt in a church like this, back in the early part of the 19th century, what we waited for, end, abolish slavery. It took another 17 years to bring them around. I hope that the fight to end our fossil fuel companies will not take that long, but it's to say that we, in a Christian sense, understand the business of persuasion, tenacity, and staying.
I've been told I need to move on to round two of the audience questions. I'm not sure which of our guys has got the rope in mind. Three questions together. So this guy here, and the left
there. Right. I've listened to the climate. The bishop is speaking, and the content and their speech is very good, but you concentrated a lot on poverty over peace. The man is sick for them in old pension, and I think we should do an awful lot more to eliminate pension and poverty. The state pension, even if we get this chip a lot next year, it's going to be less than 9,000 a year. I don't know how any MP could sit here and see they want to eliminate pension and poverty. How can you expect an old age pensioner to live in London for less than 10,000 a year? And I know even today one of the Tory bitwigs was saying we should get rid of this chip of rock that's going to ruin the country. Because I know a lot of pensioners, they're either not eating their milk or not heating their flats, they're going to food banks, they're going to charity shops to buy their clothes and other things. That state pension is an absolute disgrace. So I did not listen to MPs of any party, whether the rest of MP Tory or Lib, saying what to eliminate pension for. That state pension should be 12,500 or 15,000. And I'll just say this, in case you don't know, I've worked for an MP for the last 13 years and was planning to start taking the pension next year when I proceed to 70. And just 2 or 3 weeks ago, I got a valuation of my pension from Aviva and people in general. And my pension fund was Aviva.
Sorry, can I move you on to the question?
Right. Has dropped. I've already asked. Has dropped back up. So, the state pension is an absolute disgrace. So, we should be trying to eliminate pension authority in this country so that pensioners don't need to go to food banks and charity shops and even. To get a half decent standard of living. That's what